Contracting or subcontracting is an arrangement whereby an employer or principal engages the service of a contractor who undertakes to perform a certain work, task, or job on his own account, under his own responsibility, free from the control and direction of his employer or principal in all matters except as to the result of the work. Note the distinctions between recruitment and contracting. 1. In recruitment, the recruitment agency engages a job applicant for the purpose of placing him with an employer. In contracting, the contractor undertakes to do a specific job or service using his own employees for a principal. 2. In recruitment, there is a need for a license. In contracting, there is a need for registration. In legitimate contracting or subcontracting, a trilateral relationship exists, to wit: 1. The principal who decides on the job to be contracted out. 2. The contractor who undertakes to perform the job. And 3. The workers who accomplish the job. Contracting or subcontracting of a job, work, or service is not illegal per se. The recognition of the right of an employer to engage the services of a contractor for the performance of a specific work, task, or job could be gleaned from Articles 106 and 107 of the Labor Code of the Philippines. For contracting or subcontracting to be valid, the contractor or subcontractor must have a distinct and independent business, must have substantial capital or investments to carry out the contracted service, and must be free from control and direction of the principal on all matters except as to the results thereof. Independent business presupposes that the contractor has its own occupation or trade with substantial capital necessary to carry out the contracted job or service and caters not exclusively to one client but to several clientele according to his own methods without being controlled by the client except as to the results. The contractor must have substantial capital. Under the present rule, contractors are required to have a minimum paid-up capital of at least 5 million pesos in the case of corporations, partnerships, or cooperatives, or a net worth of at least 5 million pesos in the case of single proprietorship. In a legitimate contracting arrangement, the contractor performs the job, work, or service according to his own manner and method. The principal is interested only in the result. If the principal manages the contractor on both the result of the work and the means by which the work is to be accomplished, the relationship is not one of principal contractor but employer-employee. Note the legal effects of valid contracting or subcontracting. In a valid contracting or subcontracting arrangement, employer-employee relationship is not created between the principal and the employees of the contractor. However, if the contractor fails to pay the wages of his employees, the principal becomes solidarily liable with his contractor for such unpaid wages. The solidary liability for unpaid wages is limited only to the extent of the work performed under the contract. This is the period when the contractor's employees were working for the principal. The principal is not solidarily liable for back wages of the contractor's employees. This is because back wages are invested with a punitive character, which should be imposed only against the guilty party, that is, the person who committed the acts constitutive of illegal dismissal, except when there is proof that the principal conspired with the independent contractor in the illegal dismissal of the employees. The principal is not solidarily liable for separation pay of the contractor's employees. This is because there's no employer-employee relationship between the principal and the contractor's employees. The principal is not solidarily liable for damages caused by the contractor's employees. The contractor alone is responsible for the acts and omissions of his employees. The imposition of solidary liability does not preclude the principal from seeking reimbursement from the contractor for whatever amount he may be adjudged to pay the contractor's employees. However, the claim for reimbursement should be filed before the regular courts. It cannot be done through a cross-claim before the labor arbiter because the claim for reimbursement is beyond the jurisdiction of the labor arbiters, considering that the matter does not have a reasonable causal connection with employer-employee relationship. It is a civil obligation arising from a contract. Remember that contractors must be registered with the Department of Labor and Employment. They must register with the DOL regional office where they principally operate. This is a mandatory requirement. Failure to register shall give rise to the presumption that the contractor is engaged in labor-only contracting, but this presumption is not conclusive. It is merely a disputable presumption which can be overcome by proof that the contractor has a distinct and independent business with substantial capital, work premises, and necessary equipment to carry out the contracted services, and that it performs the contracted service free from control and direction of the principal in all matters except as to the results thereof. Note the legal effect of registration. Registration merely removes the legal presumption of being a mere labor-only contractor. Registration does not bar a party from proving that the contractor is a labor-only contractor by showing that the contractor does not have substantial capital, equipment, or work premises to carry out the contracted service and merely supplies workers only to the principal to perform a job directly related to the main business of the principal. Note the contractors that are not required to register. Contractors in the construction industry licensed by the Philippine Contractors Accreditation Board. Firms engaged in information technology-enabled services involving an entire business process such as knowledge process outsourcing, business process outsourcing, hardware or software support, medical transcription, animation services, and back office operations or support. Contracting or subcontracting is illegal. 1. When entered into with a labor-only contractor. A labor-only contractor is a contractor who does not have substantial capital or investment in the form of tools, equipment, machinery, and work premises, and merely recruits or supplies workers to a principal to perform a job, work, or activity that is directly related to the main business of the principal employer. 2. When the principal farms out work to a cabo. A cabo refers to a person or group of persons which, under the guise of a labor organization, cooperative, or any entity, supplies workers to an employer without monetary consideration, whether in the capacity of an agent of the employer or as an ostensible independent contractor. 3. When entered into with an in-house agency. An in-house agency refers to a contractor which is owned, managed, or controlled directly or indirectly by the principal or one where the principal owns or represents any share of stock and which operates solely or mainly for the principal. 4. When entered into without in-house cooperative which merely supplies workers to the principal. An in-house cooperative is one which is managed or controlled directly or indirectly by the principal or one where the principal or any of its officers owns or represents any equity or interest which operates solely or mainly for the principal. 5. When contracting is done because of an impending or actual strike or lockout. Contracting out work because of an impending or actual strike is called a runaway shop because the employer relocates or transfers operations in an attempt to evade its obligations to deal with the union. 6. When contracting interferes with the exercise of their right to self-organization. Under Article 259C of the Labor Code, it is unlawful for an employer to contract out services or functions being performed by union members when such will interfere with, restrain, or coerce employees in the exercise of their right to self-organization. 7. When the contractual employees are required to sign as a precondition to employment or continued employment an antedated resignation letter, a blank payroll, a waiver of labor standards, minimum wages, and welfare benefits, or a quitclaim releasing the principal or contractor for future claims. 8. When employees are required to become members of a cooperative. 9. When the employees of the contractor or subcontractor are required to perform functions which are currently being performed by regular employees of the principal. 10. When the contractor or subcontractor repeatedly hires employees under an employment contract of short duration. 11. When the employees of the contractor or subcontractor are required to sign a contract fixing the period of employment to a term shorter than the term of the service agreement unless the contract is divisible into phases which require substantially different skills made known to the employee at the time of engagement. And 12. Such other practices, schemes, or employment arrangements designed to circumvent the right to security of tenure. Labor-only contracting. Labor-only contracting is an arrangement whereby the contractor who does not have substantial capital or investment in the form of tools, equipment, machinery, and work premises merely recruits or supplies workers to a principal to perform the job, work, or activity that is directly related to the main business of the principal. A labor-only contractor merely supplies workers. In a labor-only contracting arrangement, the contractor merely provides workers to a principal employer. The engagement is not for the performance of a specific job or service, but for the supply of manpower who will perform activities that are directly related to the main business of the principal. A labor-only contractor has no substantial capital. The phrase substantial capital or investment refers to capital stock and subscribed capitalization in the case of corporations, tools, equipment, implements, machinery, and work premises, actually and directly used by the contractor in the performance or completion of the job, work, or service contracted out. The sum of assets without more is insufficient to prove that an entity is engaged in valid job contracting. The assets must be manifested as investments relating to the job, work, or service to be performed. These investments may come in the form of tools, equipment, machinery, and work premises. It must be established that the contractor furnished its workers with the tools or equipment necessary to carry out the contracted services. It is not necessary for the contractor to prove that he has both substantial capital and investment in the form of tools, equipment, or machinery. The conjunction or is used in the law. Thus, if the contractor can prove that he has substantial capital, he need not further establish that he has investment in the form of tools, equipment, or machinery. Activities directly related to the main business. The law neither defines nor enumerates what activities are directly related to the principal business of an employer. The following activities have been held as directly related to the principal business of an employer. 1. Automobile painting is directly related to an automotive repair shop business. 2. Merchandisers, cashiers, baggers, sales ladies, checkout personnel, and warehouse men are jobs directly related to the supermarket business. 3. Lat machine operator, buffing, assembler, and quality control are jobs directly related to the business of steel and metal fabrication of machine parts. Note the legal effect of labor-only contracting. When there is labor-only contracting, the employees of the labor-only contractor will become employees of the principal, which means that they will be absorbed into the regular workforce and be entitled to all the rights and benefits accorded to regular employees of the principal. The labor-only contractor will be considered as a mere agent of the principal employer.